they were a sort of exorcism of a lot of my unhappinesses, in actual fact. Because I was a very, very dark soul when I was in that time. And I couldn't come to terms with things. And one way of dealing with my pain was to write it down. And all of the sort of polarizations of things that were going on, like, you know, the extremes between being immensely happy and looking towards the beauty in life, and then knowing that underneath it all was a sort of tragic undercurrent that was pulling me down. They were all encapsulated in those songs, and they were little sound bites of very intense feelings, actually.
I need you to pin me down just for one frozen moment. I need someone to pin me down so I can live in torment. I need you to really feel the twist of my back breaking. I need someone to listen to the ecstasy I'm faking.
Yeah, well, gradually, as Eurythmics became successful and we did world tours and the whole paraphernalia that goes with it, and we started meeting different people and entering into different areas of our lives, that sort of psychicness or whatever of the songwriting became harder and harder, till in the end, on the last album, it was an effort. And as soon as we felt it was an effort, I think we wanted to stop it.
We fragmented. We moved, we went into other places. I mean, that sounds really odd to say it, but we sort of grew apart, and it became impossible for either of us to bear being together in a room. I mean, we couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand it, and I don't think Dave could stand it. We'd been through such a lot, and there was a lot of resentment and a lot of unexpressed rage, and there was a lot of rage that had been expressed also, but it was never quite really rounded off properly. And I think, in actual fact, when you've had to go through what Dave and I went through together, and in the end, we sort of were kind of forced together because we were this entity, and it was roller coastering, and it's like a kind of avalanche. It was getting bigger and bigger at a certain point. There was a certain degree of resentment, you know, about stepping on each other's territory. And there was a great deal of frustration also, because actually, when I think back on it, it was very, from my point of view, very, very essential part of my development as a person to become an individual in my own right. It was not possible for me to grow and develop as an adult, in actual fact, until I broke away from Dave and Eurythmics. Because right up to that point, for some reason, I had always invariably thought, I can't do it without Dave, I can't do it without Dave, I'll have to ask Dave. It was almost as if I was looking to him, not as a father figure, but as somebody to give me the authority to carry out the things that I wanted to do. But I'm very grateful, you see, even though there's bad blood, there is bad blood between me and Dave, but even though there's bad blood, I know that actually the growth that's taken place between us has been extraordinary, and I'll never forget that. I'm very, very positive about that. And I have to say, I only wish Dave well, really.
When my mother and father broke up, and I can't remember how old I was, maybe I was 13 or something like that, I think I just went into denial, basically.
What was it that you were denying?
Probably the fact that they'd broken up.
So you were denying an emotion?
Yeah.
And what was that emotion?
I say, I didn't cry or anything, or didn't...
So you held back tears?
I didn't even kind of question it.
My mum and dad kind of separated and then subsequently divorced. And that probably, well, you know, must have affected both of us, but David was younger than I was at the time. I mean, it must have been around the time I was kind of 18 or 19 and kind of leaving home to go to college anyway, whereas David was 4 years younger than me, so he was 14 and still at school.
Well, you totally change your life, don't you? On your own 2 feet, and you're off and say, well, you know, this is what I need to do now. Although I read books about predictable crisis in adult life and all sorts of things, you know. Because it's a full-time job bringing up children, And somebody once said you were very brave to leave. And a friend who was very close said she didn't have the courage to stay. And I think that was closer.
Why did we separate? Well, you see, it was not my intention to make everybody independent, you see, to give them their independence. And when the children were small, they had a clothing allowance, a very small clothing allowance. They'd go and buy their own clothes, you see. And in the end, they got so independent, they all went, left me. Now, Sadie wanted independence, and of course my work was in Sunderland, Newcastle and Seaham, and she wanted to broaden her outlook, and she went to London, yes. I helped her down, I took her to the station.
So, I mean, looking back on it, I obviously was in some sort of denial because I didn't question it. I didn't ask anybody about it. It's just that's the way it was. Or I just sank into the guitar, so I just played the guitar constantly, non-stop.
So you expressed in the guitar what you were denying in yourself?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Which was a sadness, anyway.
Mm-hmm. I think the only time I'm really good at playing the guitar is playing sad things. Talk to each other, but I think that thing of spending 8 hours to get the drum sound and then going for every hi-hat take, not so, I tend to like it just be all like a mess, you know, and out of that mess starts to shine like a brilliant thing. And then it doesn't matter if that wasn't the song, you suddenly go, oh, this is much better than the song, let's follow this. And you just follow it. I suppose it's like having a little Tinkerbell or something flying away and you're trying to follow what it is. Sometimes it might just be the breathing of Annie's voice, or sometimes it might be a guitar chord, like the first chord of Here Comes the Rain. And you go, oh, that's the feeling.
I wanted to sign him as a solo artist because I believed in his ability to have great success on his own. And in a way, he's had to be encouraged and nurtured into that. And I believe he will have great success on his own. But it was difficult, probably because Annie Lennox was such a wonderful front person. It was quite difficult for Dave to step out of the shadows of that and actually stand up and be Dave Stewart.
What I tried to do on my new album, my solo album, Greetings from the Gutter, which I'm talking about a kind of an emotional gutter, you know, where you pull yourself up out of. I wanted to express like sheer sort of joy and what real music could be about in an uplifting way in the instrumental section. You can't really describe what it does, but I tried to create a sort of chord pattern and an orchestration and a guitar solo, which I actually stole from something in the 60s that made me have that feeling. I was walking through the park once, and there was a band called the Isley Brothers, and they had a song called Summer Breeze. Mm. And I was very, very stoned, and everything just for a second felt absolutely perfect. Mm. And this song was wafting across on the radio. And I tried to recreate this feeling for other people.